What's up, friends, and welcome back to The Nurse Nick. If you guys are new to the channel, welcome. My name is Alexis Nicole. I am a registered nurse, and more specifically, I am a NICU nurse, which is a neonatal ICU nurse. I post new videos all the time about nursing-related content, my life as a nurse, day-in-the-life vlogs, and how I balance work and my private life outside of the hospital setting. If you guys aren't already subscribed, make sure to do that below so you guys can stay up to date with all of the new content. So September is NICU Awareness Month, and so I have dedicated all of my videos this month to NICU-related content. So if you guys have not already seen it, make sure you guys go watch the first video that I made. It's going to be linked down below. It's everything you need to know before becoming a NICU nurse. So if you guys are interested in the field, interested in becoming a NICU nurse, make sure you guys watch that video. So this video is going to be more of a Q&A. So if you guys aren't already following my Instagram, make sure to do so. I asked you guys on Instagram questions you had about NICU nursing, all NICU related content, and I got tons and tons of questions, and so I'm gonna go through some of the most popular ones and answer from my own opinion. Emphasis on the my own opinion. So let's go ahead and get started. The first question I'm gonna answer, which is a great question to start with, I feel like, is what is a typical day in the life of a NICU nurse like? So I work night shifts, so I'll give you what my typical shift looks like. So I don't know if this is all NICUs, but my NICU specifically, we do baths, linen changes, and weigh at night. So how my shift goes, we get onto the unit, we get our assignments, we go to our specific pod, and then we use, every hospital has a different way of scrubbing in or whatever it is that you guys use before getting on the unit. But most NICUs have some sort of like wash station, scrub in station, something that you have to put on your hands or clean your hands with before stepping onto the unit. So my hospital, we use Avaguard. So we get our assignment, we get to the pod, we Avaguard our hands, get behind our fingernails, take off any kind of rings, jewelry, make sure we're clean up to our elbows. Then we'll go into the pod, we get report from the day shift nurse, and then we do bedside checkoffs. And so some things are included in bedside checkoff. If your patient has any kind of lines, IVs, PICC lines, you just wanna take a peek at the line, make sure that it's infusing well, it's not infiltrated. You wanna check your rates, make sure the rates on your fluids are correct, especially if your patient is on any drips like dopamine, morphine. You wanna make sure that those rates are correct on there. You wanna make sure you have an ambu bag. If your patient is on ventilator support or any kind of respiratory support, you wanna make sure that you're at the right settings, check your FiO2, and if your patient is intubated, you wanna make sure that you measure your tube. And then just some things, you wanna make sure the area is clean. Just really making sure that everything looks decent so that way, once the nurse leaves, you don't have any questions. If you don't do bedside checkoff and you just get report, the nurse leaves, and then you go to the baby and something just looks off, and now you missed your opportunity to ask the nurse when she was there. So after checkoff is done, I normally write down on my sheet. So I have one sheet per baby. This is like my report sheet. I write down on my sheets by the hour everything I need to do. So I highlight the times that the babies feed. Normally babies feed every 3 hours. If they're on a continuous feed, it's every 4 hours. Being that I'm a level 4, most of the time my babies are not bottle feeders because they're usually too sick to even bottle feed. So if we're feeding, we're either tube feeding or not feeding at all. But if they do feed, it's every 3 hours, and so I'll highlight times that they feed because everything in the NICU is based around touch times, and touch times are basically our feeding times. So I'll write down everything I need to do. I'll write down when my meds are due, if I have labs, a gas, I write down everything, and then I'll start my first round. And so I'll start with the most critical baby. I start with vital signs, then I do an assessment. I will change their diaper, I'll weigh them, and then I will do all the linens, and then the last thing I do is start the feed. Again, if they're feeding. After that, I do the same thing to the next baby and the next baby. This is actually a great point to answer another question that I had, which is ratios. What our ratios are like in the NICU. And so it's different. On level 2, it's normally 1 to 4, again, in my specific unit. I work level 4, not level 2, but on level 2, it's the less critical babies, and you normally have 4 babies, or you can have up to 4 babies. In level 3, you can have up to 3 babies, but if you have a really, really sick baby, intubated baby, or baby on dialysis, it's 1-to-1. If I have an intubated baby that's kind of sick, I may have 2 babies, and so I'll have maybe one that's intubated, on drips, and then I'll have another baby that's on CPAP, nasal cannula, something like that. But anyways, moving on with my day in the life. So after my first round, I'll sit down, I'll chart my assessment for all babies. Let's just say I have 3 babies. I'll sit and chart my assessment for 3 babies, and then I will look over notes, I'll look over orders, make sure that I'm not missing anything for the night. And then normally I have like an hour to an hour and a half in between my next round. Oh, I forgot to mention that before I start, I clean all the bed spaces. I make sure I wipe everything down, make sure that everything is like nice and organized before I start. And so after my first round, I'll take a break, do all of my charting, look over everything, and then start the next round. And I normally have 4 rounds per shift. And so I do get some downtime in between. If I have 3 babies, it's a lot less downtime. I may just have time to like chart in between and help my pod mates. But if I have 2 babies, I have a lot more downtime and I have a lot more freedom to either like do some studying, look up the disease process on the babies that I have, things like that. Basically, I'll do the same thing for all the rounds. I take vitals, change diapers, start the feeds, give meds. And then I will repeat that until day shift comes. Normally around 4 a.m. is when I do my blood gases, and if my babies have labs, I'll do all that. Now, this is a very like simple, straightforward, stable night. A lot of times it's not this simple. In fact, most times it's not this simple. Babies get sick, you may get an admission, things change, you need to grab labs, your baby spikes a fever, you need to give meds, they're in pain. Like, there's a lot of other things that happen throughout your shift, but baseline, that is normally how it would go. Another question someone asked is there any men on your unit? Yes, there are men on my unit. Not many, but they are there. Okay, so this is a good question. Someone asked if I do any communicating with parents, or is it just with the babies? I think this is a good question to address just to kind of clear up some misconceptions. You do have a lot of interaction with parents as an NICU nurse. I interact with parents almost every single shift. The one thing about night shift though is that most parents are not there throughout the night. A lot of them leave towards the beginning of my shift. I don't have many parents that want to stay through the night until 7 a.m. So we do interact with parents, but not as much as day shift. And another question I got that's kind of related to this is, how do I deal with parents that can be overbearing and parents that don't trust me? For the most part, I haven't had any bad experiences with parents, and I think a lot of that has to do with how you interact with them. Parents are gonna be nervous, parents are scared, their baby's in the NICU, they don't even know what happens in the NICU, they have no idea what's gonna happen to their baby. So I think if you lead with a very open, honest relationship, and also let the parents do as much as they're comfortable with. Sometimes I see some nurses that kind of take over and don't let the parents jump in a lot. You have to remember that this is their baby. Yes, you're the nurse. Yes, you're part of the medical team. You're taking care of them. They are technically in your care and you're responsible for their care, but this is also their baby. Especially if it's their first baby, they've never gone through this before. They don't know what to expect. Some things I like to do is just like let parents help with baths. Let parents help with like even something as small as like taking a temperature, talk through everything I'm gonna do. That makes a huge difference when you tell the parent everything to expect before you start. For example, hey mom, I'm going to take vital signs and then we're going to bathe and do linen changes. What are you comfortable doing? What can I help you with? And what do you wanna do? Just stuff like that leaves room for open communication. I always say, I'm here for you. You do as much as you're comfortable with. If you're not comfortable with it, I can do it. I can show you. I'm here for you. So just having that open communication sets a tone for the relationship. And I rarely ever have problems with parents. Same thing in the ER. I hear horror stories from parents. And of course, you're always gonna have like those outliers that no matter what you do, they're just not gonna be happy. And at that point, it's like, whatever, you did all you can do. But I noticed that if you allow them to feel like they have some control in the care, it makes for a way smoother, more enjoyable relationship. So someone asked, how do I deal with infant deaths? So unfortunately, deaths are something that we see in the NICU, especially being at such a high level NICU. Unfortunately, it's something that we see a lot more than I would like to. And every time is hard. I'm not gonna say like, oh, it just doesn't affect me. It can affect you, it can get to you, but it's important to just, one, leave it at the hospital. If you need to take a break after dealing with something like that at work, take your time, go to the bathroom, process, do what you need to do. Me, personally, I feel like I am good at separating work and personal life. And so I kind of have the mindset that I know I cannot save everyone. I know no matter what the medical team does, we can't always work miracles on everyone. And as long as we did everything to the best of our ability, that's all we could do. And so I kind of just repeat that to myself anytime I have trouble with processing a death or a sick baby. And just processing that helps me personally. Listen, another question. Someone asked, why do nurses love NICU over other units and why do they stay so long? So this was something that I heard too when I was in nursing school. My professors would always say, once nurses go to the NICU, they never go back to anything else. And honestly, I can see why. After being a NICU nurse, I have no desire to do any other kind of nursing. I don't want to work with adults, even peds, general peds. I'm kind of like, I don't know. I kind of like my NICU. And it's for many reasons. I personally like it because babies are so innocent and a lot of things that happen to them are not their fault. And you just feel like, not that you feel bad for them, but you just feel this urge to like want to help them. Like I know as a nurse, you always want to help everyone, but there's just something special that I feel towards babies. Not everyone is a baby person and that's okay, but I'm definitely a baby person. And personally, it's just a ton easier to turn a baby that is 5 pounds versus turning a grown man that is like 300 pounds. Also the diapers. I much rather change a 32 weeker's diaper than a 93-year-old's diaper. Now I know it has to be done. Someone has to do it. I used to be the one to do it. I used to be a tech on a colorectal surgery PCU floor. And so I used to do all of that. But I'm happy that I am where I am now. I really just enjoy like the criticalness and the fragility of working with preemies and sick babies. It just is so personally so rewarding to me to like see them turn around, and there's just like no other unit like it. And so in short, that is why they never leave. So someone asked, what are the skills you perform most often? So in the NICU, we do a lot in the NICU. We do a lot of NG insertions, OG insertions, IV starts, arterial sticks. I've done PD dialysis quite a few times. Something that I actually did not realize that we do a lot is colostomy bag changes. I had not realized before starting in the NICU how many babies had colostomies and ostomies. Quite a few, because there's something called necrotizing enterocolitis. And as a result of that, a lot of babies have to have some of their bowels removed and have to have ostomies. And it's a lot of it is temporary. A lot of babies get re-anastomosed. So it's not forever, but there are a lot of ostomies in the NICU. That's something I did not realize. And an interesting thing that we do in the NICU that I didn't even realize was a thing was something called refeeding. So if you don't know what refeeding is, look it up. I'm just gonna briefly explain it. But basically what refeeding is you take the output from a baby's ostomy and you refeed it into a mucus fistula. Again, that is a very brief overview of what it is. If you're interested to know more, look up refeeding. I'm not gonna gross you guys out too much, but that was definitely very interesting to me. Those are just a few of the skills that we perform. A lot of the NICU is assessments and catching little tiny things as they change. Because babies are so small, so fragile, and turn so quickly, you have to be on your tippy toes keeping up with their assessment. It's actually a great video idea for another video, is some of the diagnoses and things that we do and see in the NICU. So great question, whoever asked that. Okay, this is gonna be the last question for this video. Someone asked, was the transition to NICU difficult? I wouldn't say it was extremely difficult. It definitely was a little challenging, but it wasn't extremely difficult for me. Personally, I think it was more difficult starting as a new grad in the ER than it was transitioning to NICU. Because I already knew how to be a nurse for the most part. It's just learning all of the NICU stuff. So besides time management and knowing medications, not a lot of anything else I did in any other field really helped me for the NICU. So a lot of people say like, oh, do med surg or do you have to do something else before just jumping into a specialty like NICU? Not really, because I don't really see that it helped much for NICU. What did help is being in postpartum, I will say that. And even the ER, PDER specifically helps, because we did see a lot of infants and we would start IVs and do blood draws on infants. And so that helped skills wise. Postpartum helped because we have a lot of healthy babies there. And so I have like a baseline assessment of what a normal healthy baby looks like. And there were some times that I had to transfer babies to NICU. So I was able to learn what is normal, what is not normal, and what needs to go to NICU. And so that helped. But personally, like my adult ER experience didn't really apply. The only thing that applied is like learning time management and knowing certain medications and what they do and what they're for. Other than that, it was a big transition, learning everything all over again and learning everything specific to NICU, because nothing is like the NICU. The NICU might as well be like its own hospital, because it is so different from every other unit in the hospital. So in short, it was definitely a new experience transitioning to NICU. I wouldn't say it was more difficult than any other transition I had when starting a new specialty, but there definitely was a huge learning curve for me. But you know, we got over that hump because I did a lot of like homework, I did a lot of research on my own time, and that really helped with my transition to the new specialty. But that is the last question that I'm gonna answer for this video. Thank you guys so much for watching. If you have any other questions about NICU, make sure to leave them down below, and I will see you guys in the next video.